Good day to all our guests today, wherever you may be in the world. My name is Gordon Harris from the Gowling WLG IP Leadership Team, and I'm delighted to welcome you to the seventh webinar in our series, The Lifecycle of a Smart Idea. Up to now, we've been looking at establishing the intellectual property rights space, whether it's patents, trade secrets, copyright, whatever. If you would like to catch up on any of the earlier webinars in the series, they are available on demand at our website and at our dedicated IP platform, goexcel.gowlingwlg.com. The last time we looked at the strategies behind planning the commencement of global enforcement proceedings from the point of view of a patent owner, the claimant. This time we move to the other side of the fence to look at the strategy and tactics of the defendant as the game begins. We're going to do all this against the backdrop of a scenario based on a globally patented invention, attracting envious interest and inevitable imitation. To illustrate the issues, we'll be calling in at our offices around the world to hear from experts with enormous experience in national and multinational patent litigation. So let me introduce our panel to you briefly. First of all, Selena Kim in Canada. Selena has been practicing patent law for 18 years in Canada and has represented both claimants and defendants in cases involving a variety of technologies. She has extensive experience in managing and coordinating multi-jurisdictional litigation. She's also qualified as a patent agent before the Canadian IP Office and the US Patent and Trademark Office, and uses the insights gained from her patent prosecution practice to inform her patent litigation strategies and recommendations. John Ball in London is a highly experienced IP dispute resolution lawyer. He has over 20 years of experience in assisting clients to achieve their commercial goals across all forms of contentious IP matters, with a particular focus on patent litigation, acting for both claimants and defendants. Across the channel in Paris, Clémence Lapotre is waiting for us. She has specialized in intellectual property and information technology matters. Her expertise notably includes patents, trademarks, and software. She's built a considerable experience in litigation, including complex and multi-jurisdiction disputes, as well as in the enforcement, management, and licensing of IP rights, search and clearance, risk assessment, opposition proceedings, and settlement and licensing agreements. Up to Munich, where Jonathan Kernitz is waiting, he advises on IP law with a strong focus on patent litigation. His wide range of experience includes patent disputes in various technical fields, such as telecoms, mechanics, and electrical and mechanical engineering. Through his work on numerous high-profile standard essential patent and FRAND cases, he's also developed an in-depth expertise in patent-related antitrust law and cross-border licensing negotiations. Over in China, Ivy Liang is one of the newest members of our team, having joined our Guangzhou office in April this year. Before joining us, she was a judge in the Guangdong Provincial Courts, and she served as deputy director of the IP division, so she's fully up to date with all the recent developments in Chinese IP law. And then finally in Moscow, we have Alexander Dovgalyuk. He is a litigation and enforcement lawyer with over 10 years of experience in IP enforcement. Alexander assists domestic and foreign clients with a full range of services related to IP enforcement and litigation in Russia, including unfair competition cases, and he regularly represents clients before the IP court and state commercial courts. So there is our excellent panel for the day. Now let me set the scene. Today, I'm the client. But unlike last week, I am not the UK-based aspirational patentee, Tide Corp. This time, I'm the managing director of its competitor, Aquapower, a French-Canadian company and a long-established business in the productive management of water for energy, majoring up to now on hydroelectric schemes. Those of you who attended the last session will recall that Tide Corp is a company involved in sustainable energy creation and storage, which has developed a seemingly new method of storing electricity underwater using tidal flow, buoyancy, and predictable currents. The potential is global, but the technology is relatively simple. So Tide Corp opted for a global patenting program, majoring on coastal countries and big energy users. The countries covered include Canada, the USA, Russia, China, many European countries, as well as Brazil and Australia. As a hedge against possible complications following Brexit, Tide Corp did not designate the UK in the European patent application, but took out a separate UK patent. As we acknowledged last week, that was unnecessary, probably a mistake, but that is what they did. So there is a UK patent as well as a European patent, which designates key countries in Europe, including France and Germany. The technology involves using resistance to water flow and the buoyancy of large air-filled containers to first generate and then store electricity. Although there are similarities between the patented technology and known tidal energy generation technology, the patent has been granted globally, though not without quite a struggle in some patent offices. It is still under opposition in the European Patent Office. It was amended after the first round of the process before the opposition division, but survived, and there is now a pending appeal to the Technical Board of Appeal. The opposition was done on a straw man basis, but in truth, it is AquaPower, my company, which is funding and supporting the opposition. The technology was an instant and highly profitable success, and there has been substantial demand for investment. However, AquaPower believes that it had in fact already developed, though not yet fully marketed, technology which, if not identical, certainly employed similar techniques. AquaPower chose to keep that confidential rather than seek patents. It's granted licenses around the world in preparation for market launch. Companies in Germany, Russia, UK and USA have all taken licenses of the know-how. AquaPower is well aware of other people trying to enter this market following the sudden success and publicity surrounding the growth of the Tidecore product. In particular, there is a company in China, which is actually one of the suppliers to AquaPower, of some of the key parts. That Chinese company has its own version of the product ready to launch. So knowing that Tidecore is a well-funded company, which has been very vocal in the market about the uniqueness of its technology, I, as MD of AquaPower, am very concerned that it will come after us and our licensees. I'm also concerned it will attack our Chinese supplier, which might seriously disrupt our supply chain and our ability to meet early orders. I'm particularly concerned about being injuncted, which might damage our whole marketing strategy. And I want to know what I can do to stop Tidecore in its tracks. Now, knowing that Gowling WLG has strong global coverage across many of the countries in which I'm interested, I've asked them to give me a global view. I've gone to a lawyer there I know well, Selena Kim in Canada, and asked her to take the lead, both in respect of the Gowling offices and also firms in other countries where they do not have offices. My instructions to them are to tell me what to do to try to stop Tidecore from disrupting our market plans and to slow down any litigation they may bring. I want to know where is the best place to bring an action and what plans I need to be making now to prepare for potential actions I might bring myself. So let me start with Selena then. Thanks very much, Selena. Can you give me some initial advice?
Yes, thanks, Gordon, for that introduction. So I'll start us off by commenting on three areas that I think are particularly important at this stage. First, I'll talk about getting your international team in place. Since you have the luxury of time, as you haven't been sued yet, this is the time to get going on this. Second, I'll be talking about dealing with your licensees who may be getting increasingly nervous and needing reassurance. Then I'll talk about an offensive part of your strategy, which is getting Tidecore to start defending itself in multiple venues, but in a cost-effective and strategic way. First, it's very good that AquaPower is thinking ahead and not just waiting around to get sued. This gives you a significant advantage and head start. Once you are sued, it can become quite a scramble to retain counsel and coordinate your response. It's always better to be as much in control as possible. So in this respect, the first thing you want to do is to get your team in place in your important markets. You can get your conflicts cleared, team members up to speed, and speaking with each other. Now, at our firm, we're often asked to coordinate and implement strategies in multiple jurisdictions. Of the key jurisdictions you mentioned, we have IP litigators in Canada, Europe, Russia, and China. In the other countries, US, Brazil, and Australia, our firm has extensive knowledge of excellent local firms who have proven technical and legal expertise. We're highly experienced in coordinating between litigators in our own offices, as well as partnering with firms in other jurisdictions to serve you using a coordinated and nimble strategy. The second matter I'll discuss is dealing with your licensees. You'll want to think about how you're going to reassure them, as they may be getting increasingly nervous about getting sued or shut down by TICOR. A key question will be whether you have given your licensees an indemnity whereby you pay for costs of defending patent litigation against them. If you have not yet, you can be sure that your licensees will be asking you to protect them, so you should start thinking about the terms. In particular, if you are still onboarding new licensees and they ask for an indemnity, you'll want to structure your agreement and your royalty fees to ensure that you are covered for taking on the additional risks of having to make good on your indemnity. Now, third, I'll discuss an offensive strategy to force TICOR to defend itself in multiple venues. Now, when we advise defendants, we can often be more creative and strategic with our plans compared to when we're advising a claimant. There is simply a lot more that you can do to distract and annoy. And Gordon, you'd asked, where is the best place to bring a patent action? I think the first consideration is to step back and consider whether, as a defendant, do you want to file a formal action at all. You can request courts to declare invalidity of TICOR's patents in every jurisdiction where the patents are filed. And while that may feel attractive to be the aggressor, we do not actually know that TICOR is going to sue or when. Once you file an action in any country, AquaPower's identity is public and it forces TICOR to engage. What might be better in this case is to do more along the lines of what you're already doing before the European Patent Office, that is, filing some more anonymous patent challenges. A key place to do this is in the United States, which I'll discuss later on in our talk today. Filing such anonymous challenges will achieve your goal of distracting TICOR, forcing it to spread its resources more thinly, and making it feel less confident that its patent would survive a validity challenge in a court if it were to sue. And you achieve all this while keeping your identity secret. Of course, they will suspect AquaPower is behind all these challenges, but they won't know for sure, which is another vexing source of uncertainty for a claimant. I hope these initial thoughts were helpful for you, Gordon.
Thanks very much indeed. And it's quite clear now that there are a lot of possibilities. So what I need to do now is to look for some real detailed plans. So I want to hear from all the offices, all the different countries, about how we might best protect ourselves from attack. I'm looking to create a global strategy here to ensure that I can continue to run my business and protect my licensees. So can I start by hearing from John in London?
Of course, Gordon. I'll talk a bit more detail about the position in the UK for a potential defendant facing a patent infringement here and some of the initial steps we should be looking at making a start on. I'll pick up on the key theme mentioned by Selena to begin with, which is setting up, you know, the relevant team here in the UK. And obviously, secondly, early preparation that we're going to be looking to doing as part of the overall defence. And thirdly, I'd like to talk about the overall strategy and particularly some of the more creative options we have here in the UK as a potential defendant to somewhat take control of the timetable and take control of the initiative. Conscious, of course, of what you said, that you rather think that you'd like this pushed off as far as possible in time. Now, there are, as I say, there are some creative things we can come on to talk to you about. But coming on to the first point, getting the team together. As you may know, we still have a split legal profession in the UK between solicitors and barristers, with the solicitors preparing the case and the evidence, and the barristers being the court advocates, the expert advocates that we have to do the trial for us. Now, the very best barristers, the senior Queen's Counsel, it's quite a small pool of patent barristers. So we probably do want to get in quite early and secure who we think the best barrister, lead barrister is going to be for the case. And of course, you're welcome to be a part of that process. But probably most importantly, in the UK, the expert evidence and the quality of the expert witness is very often what wins and loses cases here. And it can take a very considerable time to find the right expert. And actually, our case law is quite prescriptive on this in the way that we deal with an expert, particularly when we're trying to invalidate a patent for things like obviousness. We have to go through a careful process of dealing with the potential expert to start getting some opinions on things like obviousness before they've even been shown the pattern. So there's no accusation that there's been the use of hindsight. Now that exercise can take a significant amount of time to work through. So early identification and working with potential experts can put us in a very good early position in the UK. By way of other preparation, if we do get sued, we will have about 6 weeks to serve a defence, which although sounds like a decent amount of time, will go quickly. So we need to get lined up early. We'll need to talk to you in more detail about possible non-infringement defences. Do we have a prior user defence if we've used in the UK before the patent? Is there a defence of the nature that this is a kit of parts and actually we're not committing an act of infringement in this jurisdiction at all? So there's lots to talk with you about that. But obviously the invalidity of the patent will presumably form the major part of our defence. And we're in the happy position of being involved in an EPO, so we know a lot of the arguments already. But in the UK, our attack on the patent has to be very focused and we really need to cut down the list of prior art relied upon to just a few very best prior art references. And of course, we can't do things like mosaicing art together here. So there's quite a lot of thought that we need to put into that. We should consider whether there's an interim injunction risk. In this jurisdiction, like Canada and America, I believe, to get an interim injunction, the claimant would have to show that they are going to be irreparably harmed if we are not stopped from infringing pending trial. So they've got to show that damages are not an adequate remedy for them. So we need to get into some of that financial evidence and market evidence early on to see whether there's going to be any meaningful interim injunction risk. Of course, if Tide Court have known about us for a while and haven't acted, then that will pretty much be fatal for their chances of interim relief here. But then coming on to that final point about thinking creatively here as a potential defendant. We'd want to agree with your strategy pretty early on that. We can deploy a range of delaying tactics here. We can take points on service out of the proceedings, for example, on the Canadian entity. We can seek to reach some agreements with the claimant over a more relaxed timetable if we are compliant on service and that sort of thing. We can certainly look at challenging jurisdiction. Now, that's a jurisdiction over the Canadian entity at all here. A decision whether to challenge has to be taken very quickly within just 2 weeks of service of the proceedings. So we need to get into that very early. But a jurisdiction challenge, even if not successful, can easily add 3 to 6 months onto the timetable at the front end before the substantive case can proceed. So it can be a very useful delaying tactic should that be what we need to do. Also, of course, you know, we can speed things up if we want to go faster in the UK. If we think that we've got a good chance of knocking out the patent here, we can try and expedite things to do that. The courts here are sympathetic to defendants who want to invalidate a patent that is threatening to stop their business. And they are amenable to getting us early trial dates if we apply for it. Equally, if we think an early UK decision might be helpful in other courts, as it's quite a well-respected judiciary that can be quite effective, we can go for something early. And there's also offensive measures that we can take by way of declaratory relief as a defendant, as well as things like a typical declaration for non-infringement. If our case is that we're simply operating within the prior art or obvious developments from the prior art, we can seek declarations from the court to that effect. And of course, we could preemptively seek to invalidate the patent even before they sue us. So those are obviously things that would expedite proceedings here. But as I say, we can be quite creative as a potential defendant here in the UK, which we should talk in more detail about some of those in due course.
That's terrific. Great many options. Seem to have got a bit of feedback going on there, but hopefully that'll clear in a moment. Anyway, right, thanks very much. Now, I know that one country with a strong track record for granting injunctions, which is obviously worrying for me, is Germany. So, Jonathan, perhaps you can help me here. What are the best steps for me to take in Germany to protect the business?
Thanks, Gordon. Yes, so you're absolutely right to be worried about the risk, at least, of preliminary injunctions in Germany, because as we have discussed last week, in Germany, preliminary injunctions are not do not only exist on paper or in theory in Germany, but are actually and regularly granted by courts in IP matters. So in the next couple of minutes, I will focus on two main issues. The first one is the risk of a preliminary injunction in Germany and how we can deal with it. And the second is just some strategies and general information about patent litigation in Germany from a defendant's perspective. So as regards the first issue, as explained last week, there's an increased risk of a preliminary injunction in patent matters if firstly, the concerned technology is relatively simple and infringement can be shown relatively easy. Secondly, if the patent and suit has already survived at least first instance nullity or opposition proceedings. And thirdly, if there's a matter of urgency, which means that the patent owner must act quickly after becoming aware of the act of infringement. And as a thumb rule, he should act within a month after becoming aware of the infringement. So in the case at hand, we already know that the concerned technology is relatively simple, and we know Tidecorp's core patent has already survived at least first instance opposition proceedings. So there might be a real risk here of a preliminary injunction. So what can we do about it? German civil procedure law provides for the possibility of filing a so-called protective brief. In this protective brief, we can and should include all arguments as to why the application for a preliminary injunction is unfounded. The protective brief can be filed via a central electronic register, and all German courts will check whether a respective protective brief has been filed before granting a preliminary injunction. Well, one essential purpose of these briefs has always been to avoid ex parte injunctions. In other words, to avoid being surprised by an injunction without a chance to first respond to the allegations in writing or in an oral hearing. Now, that risk of such a surprise attack has decreased significantly in Germany in view of very recent case law by the German Federal Constitutional Court regarding the right to be heard. Nevertheless, a protective brief can be a good proactive precautionary measure, which will also give us just more time to develop strong arguments without the pressure of deadlines set by the court, which can be very short in preliminary injunction proceedings. And in any case, it will let us sleep more calmly. So regarding the second point about strategies and general information about patent litigation in Germany from a defendant's perspective. Well, the first point to note is that in Germany, we have a bifurcated patent litigation system. This means that infringement and validity of the patent are dealt with in separate court proceedings. The Federal Patent Court deals with the validity, and specialized patent chambers of the normal civil courts deal with the infringement. So the infringement court can issue a judgment while the fate of the patent is still in question, which is one of the reasons, obviously, why you can obtain a quick infringement finding. Now, as a result, when sued for patent infringement, you need to start working on a nullity action to attack the validity of the patent immediately. Now, for this purpose in Germany, we usually team up with patent attorneys. The attorneys at law, like me, take the lead in the infringement proceedings, and the patent attorneys usually take the lead in the nullity proceedings, and both sides just work closely together to ensure that all arguments and the strategy are coordinated perfectly. Now, some defense strategies. One point is that you can always request a stay of the infringement proceedings pending a decision in the parallel nullity or opposition proceedings. The infringement court may do that if it thinks there's a high likelihood that the patent suit is invalid. But if the patent has already survived first instance proceedings, which is the case here, it is extremely unlikely that infringement proceedings will be stayed. We should also consider sending third-party notices to companies in the supply chain that potentially contributed to the alleged infringement, inviting them to join the proceedings on our side. This will not only help in view of potential recourse claims, but it may also significantly increase the cost risk for the plaintiff, because if Tideco loses the case, it will have to reimburse not only our statutory costs of the proceedings, but also the costs of all intervening parties. And Gordon, you mentioned that Aqua Power believes that it had already developed the concerned technology, or at least a very similar one. So like John already mentioned, obviously we need to look closer whether there's a prior use right here. And a very common strategy is also in Germany to contest the claim in standing to sue. In particular, if there has been a change of ownership with respect to the patent and foreign law applies to the transfer, there's a chance for the defendant to push for an expert opinion on the effectiveness of that transfer. And I've seen cases which were delayed for almost 2 years just because of these kind of issues. It's important to understand, though, that this strategy does only work with respect to damages claims, not the claim for injunctive relief, because for that claim, it doesn't matter who owned the patent in the past. But since both claims are usually asserted in the same proceedings, it is absolutely possible to put the injunction on this slow track as well. So those were just a few initial thoughts, and there's much more to say, of course. So if you do have any further questions, please just, you know, drop me a line or give me a call anytime. And for now, back to you, Gordon.
Thanks very much, Jonathan. And we're only two jurisdictions in, but the thing that is already occurring to me is the range of different options which are available in different countries. So that makes me look forward to what I'm going to hear more of from other countries now. I have very particular concerns about my supply chain, and I'm genuinely worried that if my key parts flow from China is interrupted, I will not be able to keep the business going properly. So Ivy Liang, can you help me in China? How can I best protect myself there?
Yes, Gordon. When talking about strategies, I'm thinking about the strategic portfolio of PPP here, which means the precaution, the proactivity, and the procrastination. So first, the precaution. That's the strategy before action. Taking precaution is key to prepare for any possible actions. We will firstly prepare for the invalidation proceeding in case Tideco targets us or our supplier in China, of course. We have the similar route here in China with what Jonathan mentions about in Germany. China also adopts the bifurcated system, which means the channel used to re-examine or invalidate a patent is separate from the channel used to determine patent infringements. As the course of action for Tideco here is vested in its patent rights, we will of course try to invalidate the patent rights in the State Intellectual Property Office as the first step on this regard. I think our clients, Aqua Power, must be keen to keep the evaluation plan secret and only give Tideco a strike with the full preparation and at the best timing. So the first thing first to do here is to do the internal assessment on the merits of the invalidation. We have many talents in our firm in China and all around the world, of course. For example, under this circumstance, as the patent may involve electricity and electronics, we'll then light up our colleagues who are patent attorneys, excel in this field, and set out our analysis and suggestions in the assessment report. I also understand that the core patents of Tideco is under opposition in the European Patent Office. The arguments of invalidation are kind of similar in nature in many countries. So as being part of the international law firm, we have the privilege to liaise with our colleagues all around the world. For example, I will instantly speak to my colleagues Clement and Jonathan in France and Germany, who are working closely on the evaluation with the client, and get the first-hand information from them to support our assessment report in China. With this assessment report in hand, we can then file the invalidity declaration to the State Intellectual Property Office whenever our kind of things fit. So that's the first step. The second step is the proactivity. That's the strategy before potential litigation. We'll firstly think about suing for declaration of non-infringements. given the cost concern and the uncertainty result of litigation, I truly suspect that the Thai court may probably send over the cease and desist letter to our Chinese supplier first without initiating the civil proceeding. Our Chinese supplier may then refrain from supplying products to our client because whether Thaicorp's patent right has been infringed upon is still pending. So this will seriously obstruct our supplier from supplying the key parts to Aqua Power and cause much trouble to our market plants. In China, to eliminate this uncertainty, it is possible for our side to take the proactive measure by initiating a civil proceeding to the court and sue for a declaration of non-infringement. The purpose of this mechanism is to regulate the excessive issuance of warning by the alleged right holders and avoid the prolonged disturbance, which will cause much damages to the other party. Therefore, we will actively support our Chinese supplier to give a written notice to Thaicorp and demand it to exercise its rights. If Thaicorp is just bluffing and never respond or take any substantive actions, and then we have already had our preliminary assessment report ready, we may think about initiating the civil proceeding of declaration of non-infringement. And then we can take a more proactive approach and change from being passive to being active. The last step will be the procrastination. That's the strategy during the litigation. First of all, I think about applying for stay of the case. As I mentioned above, another byproduct of filing the invalidity declaration to the State Intellectual Property Office is to stay the case in court. In China, with regard to any case accepted by the People's Court concerning the infringement of a dispute over a utility model or design patent rights, if the defendant raises the invalidity issue and files the application, the court shall stay the case and wait for the decision of the State Intellectual Property Office. As you may remember, I mentioned earlier that this procedure may take a very long time, for around 1 to 3 years in total. When the State Intellectual Property Office comes up with a decision, either the applicant or the patentee who disagree with this decision may bring up an administrative litigation against the SIBO for the first instance, and of course can appeal later, which may significantly make the life difficult for the claimant. And we can also think about applying for jurisdiction challenge and join the possible third party in the case. It is almost the most common strategy which the defendant takes to postpone the civil proceeding in China. Although judges, including the old me, are not quite pleased with this, but the law is law. We have to accept and give a decision on this jurisdiction challenge. For filing the jurisdiction challenge and appeal later, it may possibly postpone the whole proceeding for around 2 to 3 months. In addition, we may even complicate the matter by applying for joining the related third party in the litigation. For example, possible suppliers or manufacturers in the supply chain of our Chinese supplier. Things will become really complicated if these suppliers or manufacturers are from overseas and they need to be served via the Hague Convention. So those are some opinions from China. Well, now let's just hear some smart ideas from our colleagues, Alexander in Russia. Alexander, what's your suggestion for Gordon?
Alexander, Alexander has frozen. No, he's back.
No, I'm here.
Away you go.
Okay, sorry. Well, the good news for the defendant for Aqua Power in Russia is that the claimant, Thaicorp, will never get a preliminary injunction in Russia. Such option exists in theory, but in practice, Russian courts just don't want to grant it. For no matter how strong the position of the claimant is, this just doesn't work for us, fortunately. There are no declaration type of proceedings, which means that the only here is the nullity action. Just like in Germany and China, Russia adopts a bifurcated system, which means that invalidity or nullity cannot be raised as a defense within the framework of infringement proceedings. The defendant would need to launch separate proceedings before the Russian PTO patent office. In order to nullify the patents, pending the nullity proceedings, but they do not exercise this right very often. Therefore, given that the patent litigation, infringement litigation, develop and moves faster than in other jurisdictions, then the tribunal can render its judgment on infringement faster than the Russian patent office hears the notification case. Therefore, as Ivy and Jonathan noted, it is crucial to have the nullity action prepared well in advance. It was while collecting all the evidence of available prior art from other jurisdictions as well, and prepare the statement of claim as well, and to be ready to shoot the action immediately after. If call takes the infringement licensee, probably it may be effective to shoot this action even before Tide Corp's acts against Russian licensee, if it's okay from the global protection perspective. For example, if we are already sure that the patent is weak and we have already succeeded in some other jurisdictions. Is nullity action. As for defenses that we think of within the framework of infringement proceedings, I would say there are three defenses we can raise. The first one is just as an evident one to claim non-infringement. Russia, as there is no discovery in Russia, the burden of proof is on patent.
Yeah, we are having serious technical problems here with Alexander. We're only getting part of what he's saying. So what I'm going to suggest we do is move on from Russia now, and hopefully we may be able to come back and pick up some of those points a little bit later on. So let me pick up then and move to my home market. The home market for my company is France. It would be very serious indeed if we suffered business disruption in France. So, Clémence, can you put my mind at rest? And what should we be doing to prepare for litigation in France?
Yes, thank you, Gordon. So, as you mentioned, Aquapower is a Franco-Canadian company whose technology has been licensed to companies in Germany, in Russia, in the UK, and in the US. As a licensor based in France, Aquapower should consider how to coordinate action or reaction in France and Europe-wide, for sure. And to that end, I will discuss potential steps that Aquapower can undertake at three different stages. Before any infringement action from Tide Corp, within the context of an action initiated by Tide Corp, and in the event that Aquapower decides to take the initiative of an action. So, first, Aquapower needs to prepare for possible action by Tide Corp. In this context, Aquapower shall consider to coordinate actions abroad, but also to prepare itself in France. So as Selena and Ivy have indicated, it may be desirable to support Aquapower licenses and suppliers outside France. In this respect, we've noted that as a precautionary licensor, Aquapower has already taken the initiative to oppose Tide Corp's European patent through a straw man. And this is crucial because an opposition filed against a European patent before the European Patent Office is deemed to be against all countries designated by the patent. So if successful, the patent will be invalidated Europe-wide with a retroactive effect. We know in this respect that the patent has survived in an amended form and the appeal is now pending. As a result, cancellation should not be taken for granted. But in any case, Aquapower should consider continuing the opposition proceedings since it can help delaying Tidecorp's actions. It can also share the material gathered to support the opposition since its licenses may have complementary information that could be useful or may need it to file protective brief in Germany, as John mentioned, or challenge anonymously the patent in the US, as suggested by Selena, which seemed an interesting tactic as well. In France, Aquapower cannot file a protective letter against potential ex parte injunctions. So there is no potential anticipation on that front. That being said, Aquapower should get ready in case of seizure or saisie contrefaçon in French. And we mentioned it last week, seizure is a powerful tool that enables a patent owner duly authorized by the judge in ex parte proceedings, so to get the surprise, to have a bailiff, usually assisted by a patent attorney and other experts, enter the premises of the alleged infringer and search evidence of the infringement and its extent, meaning technical but also financial information. And all data legally and lawyerly gathered can be used in litigation by the claimant, even if abroad. So it is really crucial to get prepared for such measure. There is precaution to take upstream that can include giving instruction to the employee not to respond to any bailiff questions or make any statement if they're not authorized to do so. There is precaution that we can take during the seizure. Those can include informing your counsel from Gowling and ask him to come and assist during the seizure. We can also raise the confidentiality of sensitive technical and commercial information. What we have to know is that if a seizure has been conducted, it automatically means that an action on the merit will be brought against Aquapower, which leads to my second point. In France, there is no bifurcation, and in case of infringement action, the validity and the infringement of the patent will be assessed simultaneously in the same proceeding. As we mentioned last week, there are good chances that no stay of proceeding on pending the outcome of the opposition will be granted. Nevertheless, there are several ways that Aquapower can try to implement to build a solid defense strategy in the framework of an action on the merits. And among the numerous possibilities, I will name three. Challenging the validity of the seizure or the bailiff report, challenging the validity of the writ of summons or raising other incidental procedural defenses, as well as challenging the validity of the patent as a counterclaim. But this is my third point, and Aquapower can also consider taking the initiative on an action, and in particular, since he is the licensor, and he can do that on three different grounds. The validity of Tidecorp patents, the absence of infringement, and the prior personal use. As per the first ground of validity, in France, like Oregon or the jurisdiction in Europe, there is a risk that cannot be entirely ruled out, but the court sees of an invalidity action will stay the proceeding pending the European Patent Office decision. However, we know that Tidecorp also holds an independent UK patent whose validity can be challenged. And as a result, as a means of pressure, with the help of John, Aquapower could also opt for initiating invalidity action in the UK, which is known as a feared, an expensive, and a technical jurisdiction. As John mentioned, Jonathan from our Munich office, within the context of a torpedo strategy, Aquapower can also consider bringing a declaration of non-infringement in France. A declaration of non-infringement can be introduced by any operator providing evidence, at least, of serious preparatory acts for industrial exploitation, and asking the patent holder to state whether the patent could be infringed by such exploitation. If Tidecorp fails to answer within 3 months, which is quite short, or in case of disagreement between the parties, Aquapower could bring an action before Paris Court to rule that the exploitation of her technology does not fall within the scope of Tidecorp patents. As an alternative, Aquapower can also, and we've discussed it, consider and claim that it was in possession and putting into use the invention prior to Tidecorp. And this is prior personal use that can be invoked, provided that the features of the technology used are identical to the patent and that the use has started in good faith prior to the filing date of the patent. In this respect, I think that we have noted that Aquapower has protected its technology through trade secrets and may not be willing to disclose it. However, since the implementation of the trade secret directive in France, there is procedural tools and solutions to preserve secrecy despite an action and proceedings. Those are, for instance, confidentiality club, hearing with restrictive audience rules, and publication of judgment redacted of any technical information. I will add that in any case, those strategies are not free of certain risk. In particular, they expose Aquapower to risk of infringement counterclaims, and should the decision be in favor of Aquapower, it would not prevent Tidecorp from bringing an infringement action in the event that the exploitation of Tidecorp is not carried out under the specific condition mentioned in the declaration of non-infringement or in the prior use action. This was for France, and that being said, I will give the floor to Serena for the strategies that can be implemented in the US or Canada.
Thanks very much indeed, and thank you particularly, Carlos, for raising that point that under the directive on trade secrets in the UK, in Europe, it is possible that we could use our own material that we consider to be secret in a prior use action without necessarily disclosing it more broadly. I think that's a really important point. Right, well, thank you very much, Kamal. So our main business base is in Canada, and the US is potentially our biggest market. So Selena, we've saved the biggest till last. Over to you. What can we be doing in North America to protect ourselves?
Thank you, Gordon. Just before I start on Canada and the US, I thought because of the sound difficulties and the connection difficulties we had during Alexander's part of the talk for Russia, I would just summarize a couple key points from Alexander's section. Alexander explained it's a very, very defendant-friendly jurisdiction in Russia. I'm totally jealous. You've got lots of power as the defendant. First of all, there's no preliminary injunction that's practically available to the plaintiff. And in terms of discovery, there is none. So Tidecorp is on its own in terms of trying to collect evidence of infringement. And it sounded like the courts are even reluctant to give access to plaintiffs or to even independent experts in terms of access to premises in order to gather evidence. So it sounds like plaintiffs have a real uphill battle in Russia, which is great for our case. Now, returning to Canada and USA, so there's two things you want to do. First, I mentioned filing anonymous patent challenges before patent offices. This is a very effective and well-established defendant strategy to use before the United States Patent and Trademark Office. And there's really little downside in proceeding right away before that agency. In Canada, it's also possible to file a similar challenge before the Canadian Intellectual Property Office, but it's much less commonly done than in the United States. And this is because traditionally, CIPO has been more likely to reinforce the original decisions of their patent examiners, and procedurally, there's less opportunity in the Canadian Patent Office's procedures to make oral argument before the decision makers. So it's generally preferred to challenge validity in a court where you have much more capacity to engage persuasively with the judge and make your case. Now, this situation is evolving, but at this time, I'd recommend proceeding only with a challenge before the USPTO. Second thing you want to do is you want to prepare in the event that Tidecore applies to the U.S. International Trade Commission for an exclusion order blocking your products from importation, or for a court injunction in Canada or the U.S. To counter Tidecore's prospects in all of these situations, you should brainstorm with your counsel and think about evidence to support your position that Tidecore would not suffer irreparable harm if you're allowed to continue your activities pending a full determination of the dispute. If you have good evidence ready, this will really go a long way in protecting you from exclusion orders and injunctions in Canada and the US. Back to you, Gordon.
Excellent. Thanks very much indeed, Selena. That's great. Well, I have quite a lot to think about, don't I? It would be really helpful if I could get one of you to pull things together for me into a summary of that advice overall. And I'm going to ask John in London if you can do that. So, John, can you give me a little pull together of what we've just heard?
Yeah, certainly, Gordon. There was obviously a lot of ground covered there, but if I can just start drawing some of the key strands together and some key strategy decisions that have started to emerge. One of the key risks identified is clearly the injunction risk, or the interim injunction risk in Germany. They're still available in practice. So getting that protective brief filed early to give us a chance to proactively take matters into our own hands before something does get filed against us is obviously a key first step in that market. Likewise, in France, Clemence identified this risk of the seizure procedure there, which is a very, very powerful tool in the hands of the claimant. Now, I think we do need to get lined up as soon as possible to try and do everything we can to mitigate against that, insofar as it's possible to do so. That very much needs to be top of our mind, given the importance of the French market. I think it's interesting that of the three jurisdictions in play here, Germany, China and Russia, they have this bifurcated proceeding. So the nullity or the invalidity of the patent is held in a completely separate court. But to mitigate the infringement court risk, we really do need to get on quickly and file very strong nullity suit if we think we're going to be attacked in those jurisdictions. And staying on the nullity theme, Selena outlined some specific challenges that can be brought, particularly in the USPTO, which can be powerful defensive weapons. So again, I think going on the attack on the nullity side, we need to think about the US options as well, maybe Canada less so, given Selena's advice there. I mean, Russia is an interesting one. Alex broke up just when he was talking about this, and Selena summarized the advice from Russia. But the claimant is in not an easy position there to bring an infringement case. And we can certainly play that to our advantage. And I think with the common law jurisdictions, UK, Canada, US, there's a range of creative options to go on the offensive by way of declaratory relief. I think interim injunctive relief is something we need to look at, although it may be less risky for us. But also, given the fact that all three of those courts have full cross-examination of experts and deposition, etc., we do need to really focus on our expert evidence in defending those jurisdictions. But again, France, China, I mean, as you've heard, there's a range of different offensive tactics that can be deployed, and we'll need to bring those together in a meaningful way to help you through all of that. And then finally, the contractual matrix in the client's position within the supply chain is going to be, unfortunately, a complicating and challenging issue to be managed throughout the matter. And international coordination on that is going to be critical to the success on that, Gordon.
Thanks very much. That really, really pulled things together very nicely. And thank you to all of you for your advice. Now, before I make any final decisions about strategy, I'm keen to follow up with a few questions that we've picked up along the way. Now, sadly, today's the day we're finally doomed to have technology trap us. We've done very well up to now, and this is the seventh of these events, and technology has supported us, but we lost Russia for a while, and now we've lost China. So Ivy is not around to answer the question that's come from the audience about SIPO, but I can answer it for you, and the answer is that yes, you can bring an invalidity challenge in the State Intellectual Property Office in China on a straw man basis. So to answer that question, the answer is yes, you can do it, as you can in Europe, on an anonymous basis in China. So just picking up on a few other issues and other areas. Jonathan, is there a counteraction seeking a declaration of non-infringement in Germany?
Yes, there is. So you can file such action before you have been sued. So before the very same question of infringement is already pending before a German court. But in order to do that, what you need is a real legal dispute between the parties about a legal relationship between them. And in patent litigation matters, this is usually the case if you get a proper warning letter saying, this is my patent, you're infringing it, and I have claims against you. Now, this warning letter is therefore a risky strategy, also because, as Clemence mentioned, there's a risk of torpedo complaints in Europe based on a European patent. So what is likely to happen in Germany if somebody intends to sue you in main infringement proceedings is that you will either get a letter with very soft language, which will not constitute a legal dispute between the parties yet, or you will just get sued out of the blue.
Right, thank you very much indeed. Well, that's a pretty stark warning. Thank you for that one. Selena, I've heard that there are particular issues in Canada concerning the availability of defendants' profits. Can you just top me up on that? Because that makes me a little bit nervous.
Sure, Gordon. This is a key risk to defendants in Canadian patent litigation that does not arise in the US, where you're essentially limited to your damages. So in a Canadian patent case, the claimant is generally entitled to demand, if successful at trial, either the defendant's profits or the claimant's own damages. Now, profits are usually chosen because they are typically higher than the damages. Further, under our law, the profits are calculated differently than in regular business practice because you're only entitled to deduct variable costs from your revenues. So in general, you cannot deduct fixed costs such as head office expenses or other costs that do not tend to go up and down with the volume of infringing activity. So this can result in very high profit awards in Canada. So in some cases in the past, the profit award in Canada has been larger than the damages award in the corresponding US patent litigation, despite the much larger market size in the US. So this is definitely an aspect of Canadian patent litigation that's important for
yes, that is.
You to be Thank aware you. Of.
That is very different. It is very different to Europe. In the UK, I would say that profits, you know, can be made to disappear by accountants acting as magicians. They seem to disappear. There we are. Things are happening in an exciting fashion. Ivy, are you there?
Yes. Okay, sorry. Yeah.
So I did have one more question for you, if you were able to deal with it, if your technology will hold up, which is we've heard from a lot of countries that about some of the very creative things that can happen. Is there anything other than patent law which we could use in China? Is there anything that we might do that it'd be extremely interesting and fun?
Yes, Colin. Sorry, my computer is having a bad mood. So. I think that we need to appease our important customers because patent litigation will be, of course, of much concern to our customers. So they may require an explanation of the infringement issue and an indemnity, as mentioned by Selena. So sometimes they will place future orders on hold, exactly what the patentee wants. Some plaintiffs send letters to the defendants, customers, and falsely inform of the customer's potential liability. In this case, I think the defendant, us, should take the initiative to contact our importing customers and obtain legal opinions on possible risks, or think about bringing a separate action of unfair competition against the claimant with a course of action of commercial defamation, maybe. That's my suggestion.
Wow, thank you very much indeed. Well, many thanks to everyone who's attended today, and indeed, any of the webinars in our series so far. We really appreciate your interest and support, and I hope we've been able to give you some insight into the early stages of patent litigation from a defendant's perspective. Many thanks to my panel for all the preparation and thought they put into this, and they've certainly thrown up a lot of ideas. And I suppose my big takeaway message from this is this: there are lots of different strands of options, lots of different possibilities in arising in different countries around the world. Things that can be done very differently from one country to another in order to achieve the overall legal and commercial goal. And the risk always there is that you end up saying something in one country which actually supports the submission you're making there and damages the position somewhere else. So having a really strong team of lawyers acting in concert and with lots of planning and coordination is clearly the best way to proceed. This is exactly the same conclusion I reached last week from the claimant's perspective. Global coordination is crucial to make sure that submissions made in one jurisdiction are not fatal to your legal position elsewhere. Striking hard and fast to attack the patent which is threatening you can be effective and maybe force the patentee to compromise or even clear the path completely. Well, we're going to take a summer break now, and we will be back in September to continue with this series. Among the highlights to come, there will be a branch line of webinars looking at designing, branding, and advertising the physical result of our smart idea, as well as more in the dispute resolution space, looking at the use of international arbitration and mediation in patent cases. Artificial intelligence will come up, and the many complexities of evidence, including experts, experiments, and disclosure. We'll take a really good look at all of these issues. In the meantime, a recording of today's session will be available on our website and at goexcel.gowlingwlg.com in the next few days. Please feel free to watch again or to recommend this to one of your colleagues. Indeed, the whole series of these webinars is now available as a package at those two venues, so please feel free to share or dip back in if there's anything that you may have missed along the way. Thank you very much indeed for your kind attention today and for taking the time to join us. Have a great summer. And we look forward to seeing you again in September as we continue to pursue the life cycle of a smart idea. This broadcast will terminate automatically in just a few moments. Thanks very much indeed.